Welcome. You're about to listen to an encouraging, life-changing message presented at Joy Christian Center, Basildon.
Praise the Lord. Okay, we have been talking about exploits, and our theme and mandate for this year is a year of exploits. And we have been unpacking our theme for this year. And so far, we have established from Daniel chapter 11, verse 32. The Bible says in Daniel 11, 32, that those who violate the covenant, he will flatter. Amen. He will flatter them. But the key part of that verse says that but the people that know their God, amen, he will seduce with flattery those who violate the covenant, but the people that know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Amen? Amen. The enemy, the Antichrist, will flatter and will seduce the people that violate the covenant, the Bible says. But it says, but the people that know their God, they shall be strong and they shall do exploits. We have identified from this verse alone three ingredients that we need in order to do exploits in our Christian walk. And I want to name them to you quickly. They are knowledge, that is the knowledge of God. Knowledge is important, especially the knowledge of God for you as a Christian. Strength and action. Amen. The people that know their God shall be strong and take action. They will do exploits. So strength. And strength, we have actually described strength as your ability and capacity. Somebody say ability and capacity. It is not enough to know you have abilities, that you are able to do certain things. You also have to know that you have the capacity to do it. Praise the Lord. Capacity has to do with time. Amen. And position. So you may have strength in the sense of ability, but you also need to have the capacity to do it. I don't have the capacity to do certain things because I just don't have the capacity. Praise the Lord. But there are certain things I can do because I've got the strength and I have the capacity. I've got the time, I've got the energy, I've got the insight, I've got the know-how. And that is what we call capacity. Praise the Lord. And also we know that the third key in Daniel 11:32 is action. To do exploit, you must learn to take decisive action so that you can produce remarkable work. Hallelujah. Amen. Last Sunday, we talked about the fact that we need the grace of God to do exploit, because we can know everything we want to know and we can understand everything about our abilities and capacities and even have a strategy for achieving things, but without the grace of God, we will labor in vain. Amen. Today, my brothers and sisters, I would like to preach to you about pitfalls in doing exploits. Pitfalls in doing exploits. As with everything in life, there are adversaries and pitfalls or subtle traps we must all learn to avoid whenever we are doing exploits or when we are taking advantage of the God-given opportunities all around us. Every time and every day, you and I have God-given opportunities all around us. And to do exploits for God, we must learn to take advantage of these opportunities that we find. But in doing so, we need to be aware that with every opportunity, there are pitfalls or there are hidden traps or dangers that we must avoid. And to be able to do exploit from this year and beyond, we need to understand that although we may have knowledge, although we may have the strength, that is ability and the capacity to accomplish great things for God, and we are ready to take action, but in doing so, we need to know the pitfalls. And when we know what the pitfalls are, we can avoid them. Amen. And be able to do exploits. words for our God. Hallelujah. The Bible tells me in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 7 to 9, if you can turn to it, please, in the New King James Version. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 7 to 9. I'll give you just a few seconds to turn to it. If you are there, say, I am. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, from verse 7 to 9, the Bible says that, for I do not wish, this is Paul talking here, okay, the Apostle Paul, writing to the Corinthians, he said, for I do not wish to see you now on the way, but I hope to stay a while with you, if the Lord permits. That's on his way back. Verse 8 says, but I will tarry in Ephesus until Pentecost. For a great and effective door has opened to me, and there are many adversaries. Say with me, a great door is open to me, but there are many adversaries. Even in preaching the gospel, the Apostle Paul discovered on his missionary journey that there was a great, or there are great opportunities in Ephesus. In other words, the whole region of Ephesus, which is modern-day Turkey, is open for the gospel of Jesus Christ. So the Apostle Paul knew that there was an open door. They are ready to receive the gospel. They are willing to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. But he quickly also noted that there are many adversaries. Not just one, but many. Praise the Lord. There are many adversaries. Amen. And so, he said that because I have discovered this open door, and I've also noted that there are many adversaries, I'm going to stay in the region of Ephesus until Pentecost. Sometimes when you discover that in your attempt to do exploit for God or to accomplish something great in life, you are facing opposition from all angles, it is time for you to step back. It is time for you to wait and to do battle. Amen. As Bob Marley once said, he who fights and run away lives to fight another day. So if you run away from your angel, your enemies, you will face them later on. And I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news. The enemies you avoid today, when you meet them in future, they become 2, 3, maybe 10 times more stronger than they were when you first avoided them. So sometimes it is better to face your enemy now. Praise the Lord. Because now you have a better opportunity, in fact, to deal with them than later, because later they would have gathered a lot of strength. So don't run away from your enemies. Somebody say, don't run away from your enemies. Learn to face your enemies. My brothers and sisters, it is my job this morning to tell you that you have enemies. And these enemies cannot be ignored because they are real. Hallelujah. Turn to somebody and say, you have enemies. Tell them, I don't mean you. You are not my enemy. Tell them, you are not my enemy. But I want you to know, my brother or my sister, that you have real enemies. And say to them, I am not your enemy, but you have enemies. Hallelujah. You have enemies. I want to tell you these things because one of our goals in this church, as part of our vision, we have clearly declared that it is our aim to seek for the spiritual, emotional, financial, and social well-being of every member by teaching and preaching God's truth clearly and often, as well as provide the necessary training, care, and support for all to reach maturity in Christ Jesus. Our job in this church, my brother, my sister, let me repeat myself, is to seek for your spiritual, emotional, financial, and social well-being. Amen. Amen. Our goal is not just to take money from you, but is to help you make money. Amen. But before we get to the money bit, our primary goal is to seek for your spiritual and emotional well-being. How many of you know the Bible says that a broken spirit, who can bear? When you are not spiritually sound, physically you will be limited in what you can do. We all need to be sound spiritually. We all need to be sound emotionally. Amen. And when we talk about the emotions, we are not just talking about your feelings. Praise the Lord. It's more than that. And we need to be sound. We need health in our emotions. And that is what this church is set up to do. One of the things, or one of our goals. Amen. So allow me, my brothers and sisters, let me take you on a ride this morning to help you become spiritually, emotionally, and financially sound by the grace of God. Amen. Somebody say, Pastor, you're teaching good. I know I am. Hallelujah. Amen. Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. Holy Spirit, we ask you to break out right now in this house today. Yan doubles, I pray. We are going to read Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3. Let me locate it in this Bible. Okay, there we are. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3. And you were dead in trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, that's the devil, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passion of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body. Did you see that? And the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. In this short passage alone, the Apostle Paul has identified three key battlegrounds that every Christian, no exception, myself, yourself, every Christian faces and will continue to face till Jesus comes. I want to give them to you. Number one is the world. The world, the cosmos as we know it. That's your first battleground. The world is, let's say, your enemy outside. The enemy outside your body. The second battleground is the flesh. And the third, the flesh is the enemy within, right? And the third one is the devil, the prince of the powers of the air. That's the devil. Satan, the spirit beings who rules over the darkness of the ages. I don't have time to really unpack these three things, but I will encourage you and, Pastor David, if we can put that message on the website again, in fact, even if we can get the audio. Because some years back, I did a series on spiritual warfare, and I gave an in-depth teaching on the three battlegrounds, the world, the flesh, and the devil, that this is our area of struggle as Christians, and we will face them from time to time. Today, I don't have time to go into all the three areas. I'm going to focus more on the flesh. Amen. The enemy inside, that we call the flesh. Maybe I'll touch a little bit on the enemy outside too. Hallelujah. Now, when we talk about the flesh, we have many things to consider. Remember, we have three battlegrounds: the world, the enemy without, the flesh, and the devil. That's our three battlegrounds. Anywhere you face temptation, anytime you are confronted with spiritual warfare, with spiritual battles, please understand that it is coming from one of these three areas, period. It could come from all three. More often than not, they do. But sometimes they do come from one or a combination of these three areas, the world, the flesh, and the devil. Hallelujah. And so when we talk about the flesh, there are many things we need to consider. Now turn to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, we're going to read verse 1 only. I like this portion because it's going to help us. Hebrews chapter 12, from verse 1, the Bible says, therefore. Now, when the Bible starts with therefore, or a chapter starts with therefore, it is telling us that something has been said. And as a result of that, now, if you read Hebrews 11, the writer of Hebrews was talking about the heroes of faith, the Old Testament heroes of faith, those who walked with God, talked with God, those who availed themselves, and God used them to accomplish great things. In others, they did great exploits for God. We are talking about guys like Moses, like Joseph, like Abraham, like Samson, like Deborah, and so on and so forth. God used them mightily. They've been listed right there in Hebrews chapter 11 as the heroes of faith. And so verse chapter 12 now, verse 1 says, Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. Who are these witnesses? The heroes of faith. Amen? Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Moses and Joseph, Elijah, Elisha, Samson, Deborah, and all of those people that God used greatly in the Old Testament who are dead and gone. The Bible said they are a cloud of witnesses. And so since we are surrounded by them, we have their testimonies. We can read about their accomplishment in the Word of God. So since we are surrounded by them, the Bible now tells us, let us, you and I, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. In this passage, the Bible compares the Christian walk with an athletics, with a race. And it says that, listen, we are in a race, but thank God, some people have been here before. Some people have run this race before. When they kept their focus on God, when they trusted Almighty God and availed themselves, the Lord proved himself mighty in their lives. And so he's saying that let those people who have been ahead of us and have ascended to glory, let them be our witness. Let them be our source of motivation and encouragement that they did it. So now that it's our turn and we have taken the baton and running the same race, the Bible says now there is something we need to do. The writer of Hebrews says that you need to lay aside. Somebody say lay aside.
Lay aside.
Every weight. Again, lay aside.
Every weight.
And the sin that ensnares us. Can I help you with a little demonstration? Because I've been trying to think about how we can visualize what the Bible is telling us here as we seek to do exploit this year. So I came prepared this morning to demonstrate what the Bible is saying. The Bible says, therefore, since we are compassed with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight. So I'm going to use my overcoat right now as the first weight. Looks good, doesn't it? I'm covered. Now, this is weight. Amen? And although it's weight, I look normal, right? I'm dressed for the occasion. It's winter, so I look normal. But from time to time, most of us have other weights as well. And so one of the weights that we also carry is, let's say this bag represents your work. For some of us, we've got trouble in our workplace. We've got problems we are dealing with, and it's a dead weight you are carrying. That's another weight. How about some of the issues you face in your community? That's another weight. Hallelujah. And then, of course, being an African in this country, you have ancestors back there who are pouring libation, making all kinds of decrees. Some of them are even praying that you'll be deported. That's another weight. Praise the Lord. Upon all this, there's a certain weight. If this can, my glasses can represent shame, we have it on. And the Bible says that since we are compassed about, you are in a race. How can you run like this? How many of you can comfortably run with all these weights? I wish I can have more weights. Oh, but there's another weight too. I've not forgotten that one. I told you I came prepared. The other weight is this one. Okay. This is the weight of worry and anxiety. You're worried about your family. You're worried about your children. You are worried about the bills, the mortgage, You are worried about your car and everything else, right? And there are pressures from within and without. And you are always dressed. Don't I look good? I look good. I look like I'm traveling, right? But Jesus said in Matthew 11, somewhere around the 28th verse, he said, come unto me, all you who are labored and are tired. Say, come unto me, all who labor and are weary, and I will give you rest. And the writer of Hebrews says that since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight. Now, you don't just flip the weight aside. No. Because some of this weight, although I'm demonstrating it physically, some of them are spiritual and they are weighing on you emotionally. And so you can't just flip them off. For example, worry is not something you can just throw about. The way you throw them about is through prayer. Kabo Shaitan Namakasa. In the name of Jesus Christ. Father, you have promised in your word that I should not worry, that I should trust you because you are in control. Because of that, I flip aside worry of the mind. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus. I'm not going to worry about the family, about all these kind of situations. I'll bring it to the cross. Jesus, you have invited me to come to you so you will give me rest. So all the things they are doing back home, all the incantations, I lay them aside in the name of Jesus. It's becoming lighter now. And right now, Lord God, I have this work too, which is my work. Some of us, we have loaded ourselves with 2, 3, 4 jobs because you are in England. You've got to make money. But the Lord says, lay aside the weight and the sin that easily ensnares us. So you lay aside that one too. That is not to say you stop the job, but it means you stop the hassle. Hallelujah. And once we have done that, please remember also the one that is so close to you, the sin. There is something called besetting sin. Is the sin, sometimes it's one particular sin that always floors you from time to time. How many of you know what I'm talking about? For some of us, it is anger. For some of us, it is our mouth. We talk too much. For some of us, it is food. For some of us, it is gossip. Need I go on? For some of us, it's sex. The Bible says, lay them aside. Once you lay them aside, said, now you are ready to run the race. Then he said, let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Hallelujah. Ladies and gentlemen, the sin in this verse, in Hebrews 12, verse 1, the sin there is talking about the sin of apostasy. That is to completely give up on the Christian faith. But the writer also mentions weight. Why? Because sin in every shape or form makes one feel guilty. And guilt is weight. It's a burden. And we have to lay aside the burden of sin if we are going to run the race and do exploits for God. You have to lay them aside. Through prayer, through repentance, and asking God for forgiveness, we have to lay them aside. What are some of the sins that weighs us down? I've demonstrated with this. Let me just list a few. Pride. Bitterness. Unforgiveness. Unconfessed sins of the past. Seeking revenge. Anger. These are all things that can hinder us from running the race and from doing exploits for God. Then we have other subtle sins like worry or anxiety. Some of you, when you read the scriptures where Jesus said that do not worry, it challenges you so much that you start worrying about the fact that Jesus said you should not worry. That's how bad your worry is. That's how anxious you are. You worry about the fact that Jesus said you should not worry. And so your issue is that, how can I not worry? But Jesus said, do not worry. He said, how can I not worry, Lord Jesus? It is impossible for me not to worry. So even if you stop worrying, you worry about the fact that you have stopped worrying. It's chronic. But today, the Lord will set you free in the name of Jesus Christ. Worrying. What are the things we worry about? In this country, I know a few of them. You don't need the Holy Spirit to know, to tell you. The bills, mortgage, money for fuel, money for food, money for clothes. You don't pay school fees in this country. It's indirect. But you still worry about dinner money and school uniforms and stuff like that. We worry about those things, the bills. We worry about our marriage. We worry about the marriage. How come marriage is not like so-and-so's marriage? How come my husband doesn't treat me like so-and-so treats his wife? How come my wife doesn't treat me like so-and-so's wife treats him? We worry about our children. Anybody here who says they don't worry, including me, who says they don't worry about their children or have never worried about their children, please raise your hands. I need to pray for you for deliverance. We worry when they are at home. We worry when they are not at home. Especially when they go to school. We worry. I am learning not to worry about my children at all. When they are out of the house, I pray and I just commit them into the hands of the Lord. And I know the faithful God who watches over us will take care of them. So I learn not to worry. But sometimes there are stuff that worries me concerning them. Praise the Lord. I worry about important things. It's still worry though. But at least it's a good one. Amen. It's a good one. I'm not going to tell you exactly what I worry about, but we do. How many of you worry about your health? The Lord says, don't worry. I can go on. These are subtle sins that we commit. How about overeating? Overeating, food. When we mention fasting, then you start praying against pastor. I don't mind fasting, but 21 days. What is wrong with this man? Why can't we only do it for like 24 hours? Pastor, there's plenty food in England, and you want us to fast for 21 days? Overeating. Amen. For some of us, it's not overeating, but it is eating the wrong stuff, which we have adapted our taste to, so we can't stop. You need to be delivered. Praise the Lord. If I can be delivered from eating certain foods once a week, you can too. Praise the Lord. I said, if I can be set free, and it wasn't anybody who prayed for me, it was the doctor. He said, my friend, you need to watch this. I said, oh, okay, that's it. I'm done. Praise the Lord. How about overworking ourselves? Working non-stop and not having enough rest. You see, this is because the things you are worrying about have become your God, and you've started worshiping that God by making sure that you provide enough to please that God that you are worried about. Listen, I am not saying you should not work. I'm a firm believer in getting yourself one good job and a lot of grace. That makes all the difference. I said that makes all the difference. Listen, God did not create us as human doings. He created us to be human beings. We have to be. Then we can do. You don't do, so you can be. Do you understand what I'm saying? Some of us have no choice but to. But if only we will sit down and look at what we are doing to ourselves, you can analyze. I told you the other day that I met a guy who has vowed not to get himself a good job because he will pay tax. So he will be doing odd jobs. Is there a way you can work in this country and not pay tax? Even if you are self-employed, you will pay tax. You can, with the help of accountant and so on and so forth, practice what they call tax avoidance, okay? Not tax tax evasion. So tax avoidance, you don't pay like huge tax, you pay small tax, but you'll still be taxed. Even if you work for a cleaning company, trust me, the company is being taxed. You will pay tax indirectly. So to say that you don't want to get a good job because you pay too much tax, to me, is nonsense. Get a job, find a good way of minimizing the taxes you pay. And sometimes, in fact, the system allows for that. Praise the Lord. That's how the rich and famous do it. They make millions and they find ways to make sure that the tax doesn't take everything from them. Governments work very hard to close the loophole. They find more loopholes. So you need to do that. But overworking can be our problem. You can't sleep. Because whenever you go to work, you go to bed, you are thinking about your job. That's the first thing on your mind. I guarantee that if we take a survey, most of us here don't even have 8 hours sleep anymore. It's out of you. I mean, maximum 5. Because you've got things to do, people to see, places to go, and money to make. So you can't sleep. Why are you punishing yourself? Listen, when your body is sound, you'll be able to work for a long time. When your body is not sound and you don't have enough rest, my friend, you are shortening your life. So rest. Somebody say rest.
Rest.
That's the whole message I'm going to preach this year. About rest. To show you that we work from rest. We don't rest from work. Keep that till I preach on rest. Praise the Lord. How about talking too much? Saying more. Going beyond our limits. I'm more often guilty of this as well. Pastor, you preach too long. I know. Talking too much. You see, sometimes it is not how long a person talks, but it is what we are saying for that long period of time. That is the problem. Do you understand? It's not the quantity of words, but it is what we say, the information couched in that period, that is the problem. If you are preaching and you preach for long, Paul preached until somebody fell asleep and fell down dead. He went downstairs, prayed for the person. The guy woke up or came back from the dead. He went back and continued his message. That's church service. Was that wrong? No. It was one long farewell message. Even somebody dying in the process didn't stop Paul. Read it. It's in the book of Acts. Amen. But it is when we talk about unnecessary things or when we are saying things that will hurt somebody and we continue doing it, that is where the sin is. My brothers and sisters, you and I cannot do exploit for God if we allow these sins to weigh us down. So the question in finishing today, the question I want to ask is, Pastor, how then do we live the Christian life in this world so that we can do exploit for God? In my devotional time, the Lord just blessed me with a scripture this week, and it has been my meditation throughout the week. And I want to share it with you because it will help you. Amen. If you didn't get anything out of the teaching today, please take this one with you and hold on to it, because I'm still musing on this passage. Go to Psalm 131. Here comes deliverance. Here comes salvation. Here comes freedom. Here comes your breakthrough. Psalm 131. I'm going to read. It's only three verses long. Just three verses long. But I'm telling you, it's loaded. Hallelujah. Psalm 131, verse 1 and 2. It says, a song of David. Oh Lord, my heart is not lifted up. My eyes are not raised up too high. I do not occupy myself with things too great and too marvelous for me. Hallelujah. But I have calmed and quieted my soul like a weaned child with its mother. Like a weaned child is my soul within me. Oh, Israel, let me add verse 3. Hope in the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Now, I'm sure it's up there in the King James Version. Go to the first verse, please. Let's all read it together. Second verse is up on the screen. Please help us. Ready? Read. Verse 2. Hallelujah. The psalmist David said to God, oh Lord, my heart is not lofty. That is, there's no pride in my heart. Nor my eyes lofty. That is, there's no lust in my eye. How did I achieve this? The psalmist says. How did he come to this place? He gives us the secret. He said, in fact, the ESV says, I have not occupied, I like that word, I have not occupied myself. But the King James says, I have not concerned myself. That's another powerful word. I have not concerned myself with matters too great, nor things too profound for me. That's the weight. Most of us concern ourselves with matters too great or too marvelous. You can't handle it. You don't have the capacity to handle that. You see, I can't save the world because I didn't die for the world. Christ did. He can handle that and he has handled it. So all I need to do is to trust him. And in trusting him, I must make it my aim not to concern myself with matters too great for me. Do you know when certain things are beyond you that you can't handle? Do you know? Some of us, when people open up and they tell us things, it will crush us. It's a matter too great for you. Some of us have concerned ourselves with things that is too profound for us. And that's where our problem is. That's why we are not able to do exploits. For I have not concerned myself. Something is not your business. You have made it your business. And you are worrying about it. And it's disturbing you. And you can't sleep. You can't even eat. Because the matter is too great. You see, matter is defined as anything that has weight and occupies space. I love it. It's a scientific definition, but it works in the Bible. When you concern yourself, matter itself, okay, is something that will occupy space and it has weight. And the psalmist said, you have concerned yourself with a matter that is too great for you. Too great a matter. I mean, this thing throw light, man, into my spirit, and I'm saying, Lord God, help me to look for all the matters that are too great for me. Now I'm going to drop it like a dead weight because it's too great for me. I only have the capacity to handle what I can handle. There are certain things in business. I won't handle that. Amen? What the prime minister does in the House of Commons and number 10, that is a matter too great for me. My capacity is to pray because the Bible instructs us to pray for those who are in authority, to pray for them. But I'm not going to worry myself. What does the queen eat? How does the king, the queen, manage to be the head of state of all the Commonwealth countries? How does he travel and stuff? No. That is a matter too great for me. In fact, it's too profound for me. I won't worry my head about it at all. You know what I want to worry my head about? Is the people who sit in front of me every Sunday that I've got to preach to. Now that is my field. That's where I want to worry about. I ain't going to worry about what Donald Trump eats for breakfast. That's not my business. Is somebody getting help here? Have you concerned yourself with matters too great for you? It has occupied weight. Occupy space and is putting weight, excess weight on you. So you can't move. Spiritually, you can't move. Physically, you can't move. And yet you are shouting, we are going to do exploits. And you got the weight. Can't do exploits like that. You can't run the race. Somebody shout, drop the weight.
Drop the weight.
Hallelujah. Drop the weight. This year, we want to make a difference. And the way we are going to do it, listen, we have to learn to be selective in life. Because there are certain people we associate with, they are a weight. They are not evil, they are just weight. Pastor, what do you mean? I'll tell you what I mean. You know, you woke up in the morning, you had your quiet time, you prayed, the angels were moving. You saw the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was just blessing you in your prayer closet. And you are like, wow, today, man, this is it. I have touched the throne of God. And then all of a sudden comes the phone call. Hello, my friend. Do you know that? Then they start. And they download all their stuff on you. And all of a sudden, all the spirit eyes disappear. You become moody. Lethargic, angry, worried, you can't do anything. Now, sometimes it is important to minister to such people, but they become a weight if they are doing this regularly. If it is weighing you down, don't try to play Superman or Superwoman. Refer them. Direct them to somebody else who can help them in a better position, who can help them better than you can. years ago, I used to try to handle every counseling matter. But some of the issues were too profound for me. So I'll refer you. It's not that I don't like you. I know my capacity. I know what I can handle. So if it's a matter too great for me, I'll make a reference to a professional, somebody who is trained to handle that kind of thing, to help you. And I'll be backing you up with prayer and with support. That way, I can also be free without weight to continue this work and this ministry. Who am I talking to this morning? Some of the stuff that we concern ourselves with in our workplace can become a weight on you. You left home happy, you came back very, very moody and sad. Unfortunately for your husband, who doesn't even know about all that is going on, he asked the wrong question. Boy, he's got it. Don't you know I'm tired? You have been in the house all day. I went to work. Today is your day off. What did you do? I've been working to bring home money, and you are sitting here watching TV, and you say you are on your day off, and da-da-da-da-da, and then you give it to them. You know, da-da-da-da-da means all the things I can say. Because I'm on telly. Give them some choice words. Is the weight. The weight that besets us, it ensnares us. To do exploits, we must learn to avoid these hidden traps in our path. I am determined, and I've made it my point, that this year, I'm going to do everything I can, and I hope you do the same thing, to have a stress-free life. Amen. Amen. A stress-free life. I won't stress over certain things. I'm praying that the Lord will help me to identify, you see, this is a matter. I'll look at it. It's a matter. Yeah, is it too great a matter for me? Lord, do you want me to concern myself with this matter? This thing is too profound. Father, is this something? You see, in other words, the psalmist was saying, in simple terms, don't bite more than you can comfortably chew. Don't. Because your jaw will break. And you need it, you know, to chew your chicken bone. Sorry, I know you don't. Do you understand? Don't bite more than you can chew. Don't. It's not wise to bite more than you can chew. Don't take more than you know you can handle. Amen. My wife was talking to a certain young man recently and said, you're going to do X, Y, Z. And the young man said, look, it's just too much. I have to do this, that. It's too much. I was like, wow. This young man knows his capacity, ability. Praise the Lord. Some of us have come to the point where, I don't know, but probably because of something you experienced in your past, and I'm going to pray for people in a minute. Because of what you've been through in the past, you've been shamed. You've been abused. So this thing has prepositioned you in such a way that you can never say no to people, even if it's hurting you. I'm saying this by the Spirit of God. That's your weight right there. Sometimes the best and the nicest thing you can do for yourself and for whoever is putting that extra burden on you is to say no. David was going to face Goliath. Saul looked at him and said, son, I like your confidence and I know our God is with you. Take my armor, go and fight the giant. Take my sword, go and fight the giant. The Bible said that David put on Saul's armor, took his sword, took a step, and he stopped and said to Saul, sir, I cannot go with this, for I have not tested them. Now, Saul, the Bible described him as a man who is head and shoulders taller than anyone in Israel. That's tall. The king is taller than anyone in the country. Everyone in the... He's the tallest man. Okay? And we don't have descriptions of David, but I don't think, in terms of his height, but I don't think David was as tall as Saul. And yet Saul gave his armor to David. That's an oversized armor. Now, because he is the king, the king's armor, you know, it will come with gold and diamond and stuff on it, right? And he put it on David. If David was from Africa, he would say, I'm blessed. Look at me, I've got a king's armor. Meanwhile, he can't walk in it, but for his neighbors to see that today, me too, I've been promoted. He would try. That he would die. But the Bible said because he's smart, he turned around and he said to the king, I can't go with this. Some of us, you see, because we've been shamed, we'll be wearing the armor, although we know we can't handle it. We've been shamed. So you're afraid. If you say, I can't go with this, you'll be thinking, if I say that, I'll be disrespecting the king. No. That is concerning yourself with a matter too great for you and things too profound for you to handle. So David said to the king, sir, I can't go with this, for I have not tested them. And he took them off. What did he go to the battle with? A sling and stone. Why? Because that's what he can handle. That's what his capacity can take. And that's his ability. Praise the Lord. And he got the job done beautifully. Goliath was down the next moment. In fact, it was after he had killed Goliath that David learned to handle the sword, because the Bible says he took Goliath's own sword and cut off his head. Not Saul's sword, no. Am I speaking to somebody here? Especially those of you who can say no. I've been there, I've done that, I know what I'm talking about. You want to please everybody. Now you have ended up in a no man's land because all the people you try to please have turned against you. So what's the point? The only person you need to please is God Almighty and not anybody else. And so sometimes you need to learn to say, no, I can't do this. Well, if you don't do it, young guys, are you listening to me? Especially those friends who manipulate you. If you don't do this or say this, you will not be my friend. You tell them, no, I can't do it. It is against my Christian principles. No, I can't do it. I'm not happy about it. I don't like it, so I can't do it. Don't let anybody force you. Let no man despise thy youth. Hallelujah. We're going to pray. Somebody is going to repent in the house today. Repent of pride. Repent of arrogance. Repent of your lust. Because all these things are weight. We need to drop them. If you're having challenges that you can't control your sexual passion, although you're not married, but as for you, a guy, you have decided, you know, like he says in the song, I like to move it. So you are moving things. This is the time to say no. Devil, you're not going to use me that way. Not anymore. You are a woman. And you know, as for you, goal is I like to take it. No, don't take it anymore. Get married. Hallelujah. Get married. And when you get married, you will like to do it. Because it will be right. Shall we rise?